Well, that was, thank you, Senator. That was a fantastic PowerPoint. I myself, I'm an economist. I like a good PowerPoint, so that was really great. So I work here in Washington on federal issues, and so what I want to talk to you about is a little bit about what's going on, just across the way in D.C. and how it's related to many of the issues that we just heard about. But I want to start by reminding us of something that I'll come back to in a number of points during my comments. And I do want to warn you, I am an economist, so I do have a number of gloom and doom statistics, but I hope to end on a positive note. But let me start also on a positive note. Well, kind of. Now, the United States remains one of the richest countries on the planet. And I think what is somewhat heartbreaking about the moments that we're seeing in places like this all across the country right now is that the gains of our economic growth and the gains of our productivity over the past few decades haven't been shared. And we are now in a situation, because of bad decisions that were made in the past, especially at the federal level, vis-a-vis, in particular, revenues, we have budgets that are constrained in ways that are making us all make these really tough choices. But we need to not just think about the spending side, we have to think about the revenue side as well. We did massive. We did massive tax cuts in the early 2000s. And we were told at the time that if you just gave the rich people the money, they would invest it and they would create jobs. Now, as an economist, I mean, there's something to that, right? If you take all the rich people's money, then they can't create jobs. Okay. Well, we just lived through a massive experiment, and it was an abject failure.
Yeah.
When you look at the 2000s, in the decade, that economic recovery after those tax cuts were implemented, and you compare peak to peak, which is the fair thing to do. You look at 2000, and then you look at 2007. That was the only economic recovery in the post-World War II era where median family income fell. It had the slowest rate of investment growth of any economic recovery in the post-World War II era. You gave a lot of rich people money, they didn't invest it, they didn't create the kinds of jobs you needed, and it didn't lead to growth in incomes. So as we're having these conversations about budgets, we have to remember there are always two sides of the ledger. There's spending and there's revenue, and if you take all the revenue away, you won't be able to spend anything, so you might want to think about that over there before you get too worried about spending cuts. Okay, so that was kind of positive. So now I'm going to go back to the Senator Raskin said, the excruciating detail part. President Obama came into office on a mantra of yes, we can. And it was very exciting. I'm a labor economist. I focus mostly on jobs and employment. And it was very exciting a couple weeks ago or a week and a half ago when the president finally, for the first time in a while, I felt, came out strongly with a plan that was focused on the number one economic problem we have here in the United States, which is there are not enough people who have jobs. And you know, the thing about this is that over the past 6 months, really through all of 2011, it's been a horrible time to be here in Washington and to be following the economy, because you've had this one after another, these manufactured crises that the Republicans have put on the table to distract us from what's really going on, which is that there's 14 million people out of work. And until we get them back to work, you are not going to be able to get your fiscal house in order. I don't know where these people sort of learned how to do their math, but if you've got 1 in 10 people without a job, another 1 in 10 who's working less than they used to, you're not going to be able to pay your bills because those people aren't going to be paying the kinds of taxes that you need them to pay. You don't even raise their taxes. They're not paying taxes. They don't have a job. You're not going to be able to deal with your deficit situation. And this debt ceiling debate that happened in August was a manufactured crisis. It took our economy to the edge. They threatened to bankrupt America over an ideological dispute in a way that has not been good for the economy and certainly didn't do anything to deal with the fundamental issue, which is jobs. So let me turn for a few moments to what is in, let me turn for a moment to the plan that's on the table. When President Obama put the American Jobs Act on the table, he went back to the kinds of policies that we know work. Now, that may come as somewhat of a shock to you that the billions of dollars that we spent in the Recovery Act actually did create jobs all across America. I live in the District of Columbia, and it has been annoying for at least 18 months now because there have been people replacing 100-year-old water main on my street, which of course hasn't been replaced in 100 years because of recovery dollars, which means that there's a lot of traffic. It also means that the small business owner that lives across, that works, that has a restaurant, across the street from me, who's seen that water main break 3 times and has shut down his business for, you know, one time, days at a time, now has to deal with a little bit of construction, but after that, he's not going to have to worry about his business being shut down because we haven't invested in infrastructure. Those are the kinds of things that we're seeing going on all across America. Estimates are that we've created about 1.1 construction jobs and over 400,000 manufacturing jobs solely because of the investments in infrastructure that we did as a part of the Recovery Act. The proposal that President Obama put on the table, the American Jobs Act, puts another $140 billion towards infrastructure investments. These are the kinds of things that will get people to work quickly. Now, I know that the unemployment rate has been at or above 9% for 26 months. So clearly, what we did so far has not been enough. But that's very different than saying it hasn't worked at all. What we know is that we put people to work, and this has had what economists call multiplier effects throughout communities. What we also know is that the problem continues to be that businesses just aren't seeing enough customers. We had a housing bubble that collapsed, lost trillions of dollars from our economy, you've got 14 million people out of work, you've got a lot less money, quite frankly, flowing through the U.S. economy. And the things that we need to do now are to continue to find ways to push money back into the economy to get people back to work so they can be the kind of taxpayers that will help solve the budget crisis that we're seeing in states all around the country. So I don't want to delude any of us that one piece of legislation or one thing is going to solve our economic problems, nor will it solve the entirety of the jobs crisis. But I want us to remember that we can do something about this, that there are steps that Congress can take that will support states, that will create jobs now, and that will put us on the right footing, that we don't have to accept this sort of no we can't mentality that we hear so much about in Washington. And with that, I will stop. Thank you.